Well, good morning, Park Plaza family. It is great to be with you today. And a special good morning to all of those who are going to be watching on video today. Our Jinx gathering, our Jinx branch, and the fantastic work they are doing. The many who will be watching later on the web, those who are watching at this moment on the web. And a very special welcome, good morning, to those who this past Sunday began to meet at Rogers State University. This one snuck up on us. This was not our plan, but the first officially sanctioned event or church event every Sunday morning, the only church gathering there in the Student Center, I believe, or at least one of the buildings there in Claremore on the Rogers State campus. They began to meet this past Sunday, and they are meeting again today and every Sunday. And what a way to start off on your first day of a gathering. Go ahead and bring up that picture of our new brother in Christ, Ohio. Ohio, as soon as the service was done, they went down to the pond there at the Rogers State campus. Now, I don't know if you remember last Sunday, it wasn't exactly a spring day. And you talk about commitment. We don't have a baptistry there yet inside, but we have one outside. And so as Ohio, I hope he is there and watching this morning. Let's give Ohio a hand. We want to encourage him. Praise be to God for that. And as we talk about special events that have transpired this past week, on the heels of a fantastic ladies' winter warm-up yesterday, our men's retreat is coming up this Friday for the third year in a row. Fate Haygood is coming back. If you have never heard men, Fate, you need to be there. And as always the case, when we bring Fate in from Compton, California, we're not going to bring him that far and not have him preach on Sunday morning. And so next Sunday morning, you better be ready, okay? Because Fate's going to be ready, and we will be ready for him. We love Fate, the church there in Compton, the Metropolitan Church of Christ, and the great work he is doing. You know, we in our city have been talking a lot about racial reconciliation, especially here in Tulsa. Yesterday and Friday, I was up at a men's retreat just outside of Ferguson in the St. Louis, the greater St. Louis area. They are talking on that same topic, praying through that. As Fate comes in to our men's retreat, the Spirit is leading in a powerful way. And Ryan Smith, our brother who spoke at our summer series, the preacher from the East Virgin Street in North Tulsa, is not only coming to our men's retreat as he did last year, but is bringing several, perhaps dozens of the men from his congregation. And so we are looking forward to seeing what God is doing in that great ministry of reconciliation on so many levels, especially within our own hearts. Today we conclude our sermon series that we have titled Fast, as we are talking about the discipline of prayer and fasting. Church, thank you for allowing me to preach on this. I've been talking with many of you, and I know it has been a growing and a stretching experience for you. It has been that for me as well on a grand level. We have been going through this word FAST as an acronym. We talked about the letter F. Fasting and prayer is about placing God first and seeking His direction, His deliverance, and His designs for our lives. We talked about letter A and how people in the Bible would fast when they were missing something. They had the presence of absence in their life. Missing someone, missing God, or missing social justice, Isaiah 58, people would fast. Last week we talked about letter S and sanctification. People fasted to grow into the saints that they were called to be in Christ. And for letter T, we have perhaps saved one of the biggest reasons for last. People in the Bible fasted as a guard against temptation and as a way to participate actively in the process of repentance and coming back to God. I'd like to speak to the latter of these first, repentance. One of the most evil cities in the Bible, recorded in the book of Jonah, is the city of Nineveh. And Nineveh, as Jonah preaches the word of God to them, and they are cut to the core, their hearts are more than touched, they begin the process of repenting. The king of Nineveh says to the people, do not let any man or beast, you talk about a fast, It's not just going to be about men or women. Don't let anyone taste anything. And when God saw what they were doing and how they turned in the midst of this fast from their evil ways, he had compassion on them, and he relented about the devastation that Jonah prophesied about, and God was touched by that fast. Not only was one of the most evil cities about the business of fasting in the Bible when it came to the business of repentance, one of the most evil kings, Manasseh. This guy was bad. He was one bad cat. I think in the actual original language it says one bad cat. But nevertheless, Manasseh, as he was one who was evil, considered the evil he was doing just something trivial. All those before him, he was just as evil as them and more so. God tries to get Manasseh's attention, tries to get him to turn. Manasseh will have none of it. And so then God brings that thing that will bring him about a repentance. He brings him a discipline. And Manasseh is led off into captivity. It says that he's shackled hand and feet, and he is being led into captivity as the Assyrians have placed a, you talk about piercings, he has been pierced through the nose, and that hook is leading him on. And Manasseh now, in 2 Chronicles 33 and 13, it says, in his distress, he humbled himself greatly with this language of prayer and fasting and repentance. This morning we understand we not only need repentance, but our first point this morning, if you have a handout, sermon outline on the back is always the case, or on your smartphone, outline has been provided there for you as well on the Park Plaza app. We not only need repentance, our first point this morning is we need to be guided to repentance. And as fasting guided Nineveh, as fasting guided Manasseh, as prayer was a major part of that process in the turning from evil ways, may fasting and prayer be part of our repentance, part of our guidance process as well. God set out for those early God followers in the Old Testament a day of repentance. He set out a day of repentance so that they could have then a day of atonement. Confess, the word atonement means covered. So this day of repentance and confession means a day of atonement follows. So confession and covering leads to communion. You perhaps have heard of this day that Leviticus talks about, Yom Kippur. The day literally means to afflict oneself. And in the original language, it means to afflict one's throat. And we're not talking about doing any abuse to yourself on the outside, but your throat is afflicted because you're not feasting on those days. You're fasting. And the people that followed after God early on understood that prayer and fasting was a part of confession and covering that led to a communion as they repented of sins. It was on the calendar every year, and with Jews to this day, it remains there. You know, as we talk about that covering that comes from repentance, as we look in the Bible and see the anointing, the covering, the aromatic perfume, the blood of Christ that comes upon us, this sweet aroma, Ephesians 5 would say, he is that sweet-smelling aroma. Paul would later say to another church in Corinth, you have now become the fragrance of Christ. Early childhood years for me were filled with prayers. I remember men getting up in the pulpit and that prayer that's found in Philippians 4 and 18. Father God, may our service, may our lives, may our sacrifice be a sweet aroma. May it be an acceptable sacrifice. And we understand that this covering, this anointing comes upon us. But there are times in the midst of this anointing, in this relationship, in this communion, that we need a guide in prayer and fasting for hearts to be turned to repentance. Ecclesiastes 10 and 1, we find a very powerful word picture, metaphor, displayed for us in one short scripture. You think about some expensive anointing oil, some expensive perfume that covers you and makes you that sweet aroma of Christ. As dead flies can wreck perfume. As dead flies, I mean, now this beautiful image of anointing oil and perfume has gone from beautiful to the exact opposite. As dead flies give perfume a bad smell, so a little folly, a little sin can outweigh wisdom. And we talk about there not just intellect and answering questions, but the wisdom that is living life as God would have us live it. The wisdom and the honor and the anointing of Christ on your lives can be wrecked by just a little sin, by a little misstep. Let us be people that understand that when we come before the Lord and we not only afflict our throat, but we afflict our lives, we discipline ourselves to seek after God, letter F, first above all things. We come before Him and we ask Him to continue the process of not only covering us, but covering our church, covering our families, covering our spouses, covering our children. It's a pretty high bar that's been set. In the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 6. I mean, listen to some of these things. Do not lust. Do not judge. Love your enemies. Love your enemies. Sometimes I struggle to love my family. I mean, these, you know, I hear you going, amen, that's you, you know, as they nudge you back. These are high bars that are set. Give to the needy. Do not worry. Well, I wasn't worrying a minute ago, but now I'm worrying about not worrying. How do I pull these things off? How do I live in this covering? And in the midst of this passage that talks about living a life that is the sweet aroma of Christ, repenting of lives lived under our own power and coming back to His covering. In the midst of this, do not lust, do not judge, love your enemies, give to the needy, do not worry, and then some, right in the middle of that, verse 16. It never says, if you fast. It's not a choice. To live this type of life and this type of a covering to disciples that are following after this life that God is laying down is a gift to us. It doesn't say if you fast, when you fast, when you pray, when you say, Lord, I need you. About that time somebody says, I know it's no one in this room or no one watching today. Well, Mitch, when I get as bad as Nineveh, when I get a hook in my nose like Manasseh, when sin has shackled me hand and foot, come on, I understand why those guys fasted. They were bad. But I'm more in the Ecclesiastes 10 and 1. I got a little folly in my life. One of the exemplars of the Bible is Daniel. That was our last sermon series. I don't know if you can get more outstanding than Joseph in Genesis and Daniel in the book of Daniel. Well, this guy named Jesus, but other than Jesus, Daniel is a pretty outstanding individual. And when you get to chapter 9, his prayer is recorded. And for those of us, and I fall into this category as well as you, well, when I'm really bad, when I'm really off, and when I've got a lot of flies in my life, when there's more flies than perfume, that's when I'll really begin to seek Him. Listen to this exemplar Daniel pray a prayer. I don't know if we have a sin of his recorded in this book. We understand that all have sinned, all have fallen short. But this guy is a hero of faith. And here's how he prays. This is a freebie for you. I don't have this one on PowerPoint. Daniel 9 and 4. O Lord, the great and awesome God who keeps His covenant of love with all who love Him and obey His commands. Oh, these people You've given me, they're train wrecks. They're bad. No, that's not Scripture. We have sinned. We have done wrong. We have been wicked. We have rebelled. We have turned away. We did not listen. That was verse 4. Verse 8. O Lord, we and our kings, our princes, and our fathers, everybody, we, Daniel included, We live in shame because we have sinned against you. We have rebelled. We have not obeyed. We, all of Israel, has transgressed your law and turned away, refusing to obey your commands. Paul would have said amen and amen in Romans 3 and 23, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And that fallen is actually a poor word I just used. It's not past tense. It is we are in the process and we fall short. Let us be people who understand that God has provided us ways to come back to Him. And our second point this morning is this, and this is good news, it just doesn't deal with repentance. We need to be on guard against temptation. It deals with things before they ever get to that level. Oscar Wilde, I love this quote, "I can resist everything except temptation." You identify with that one? I'm good, except with temptation. Hebrews 2 and 17 and 18 reads this way, "For this reason, he had to be made like his brothers in every way, in order that he might become a merciful and faithful high priest in service to God, and that he might make atonement for the sins of the people." I love this sentence. I love the last one, but I love this one as well. "He himself suffered when he was tempted. He is able," now he can atone for the sins that you've done, "but he is also able to help those who are being tempted," present tense. Church, note this. Before our Lord ever dealt with Satan victoriously through his death, our Lord dealt with Satan victorious through his life. He is able to atone for sins, and he is also able to help those who are being tempted in the present tense. He has been made like his brothers and sisters in every way. We read about that great temptation in Matthew chapter 3 and verse 16. "As soon as Jesus was baptized, he went up out of the water. At that moment, heaven was open. He saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove, lighting on him, and a voice from heaven said, 'This is my Son, whom I love, with him I am well pleased.' Then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the desert to be tempted by the devil. After fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry." Here's where Matthew plays Captain Obvious, okay? After not eating for a month and 10 days, he was a little bit hungry. We need to understand that there are several kinds of fasts going on here. Not only from food, not only the supernatural fast aided by God from water, but do you notice where he is? He's not in the middle of Jerusalem. He's not in the middle of Capernaum. If Jesus was here today going through this same temptation, it would not read, "And Jesus did away with food and water, but boy, he was on Facebook like a mad, crazed maniac. He couldn't do without it. What are they posting?" He was watching the media to see what people were up to and who was mad this way and who was mad that way. Jesus was in the desert. So now we see fasting go to a whole nother level. It's not just about getting away from that which is inside you, but getting away from that which would affect you on what's outside of you. And he goes away from friends, he goes away from conversations. This morning, church, note this. Jesus, in this example, did not defeat temptation because he was the Son of God. Because if the only way Jesus ever defeats temptation is because he is the Son of God, then you and I are in big trouble. Jesus did not defeat temptation because he was the Son of God. He defeated temptation because he deliberately prepared himself to handle temptation as a person of God. He has been made like us in every way and is able and has set us an example. May we be people who say, what is that example as a person of God on how to defeat temptation? Let us do what Jesus did. And before he enters into the battle of battles, he is one who prays and is one who fasts and is one who seeks God. I'm mindful of the old story of the heart surgeon who goes in to get his car done by a master mechanic. It's really having some problems. He's got to see the top dog there in the service garage. And as he's waiting to have his car seen by this master mechanic, this intern mechanic comes up and he says, "Hey, doc, come look at some of my work." Pulls up the hood. Now he's done a fine job. "Maybe I'll work on your car one day. I'm learning here. And I guess I'm a little bit like you as a heart surgeon. I go into the heart of the matter. I replace valves that are leaky all day long. I change out parts. I make the heart of this car purr like a kitten. I do the same thing you do. How come I don't get the paycheck you get?" To which the doc, the heart surgeon, said, "Next time you work on that engine, try doing it while the engine is still running." Jesus did not turn off his humanity when he was there in the wilderness. He was tempted like us in every way. Let us, as we are tempted like him, if we want to be like him victoriously, let us understand that public displays come from private discipline. I want to be like Jesus out here. Then you need to be like Jesus in that prayer closet. Private discipline leads to public display. Number three this morning, last point of the sermon, last point of this series. We need to be directed to revival, church. Amen? 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 We need to be directed to revival. We have all been bit by sin. In God's Word, Book of Numbers, there's an interesting story where God's people have been bit by sin. Now, they've literally been bit. Before they got literally bit by a venomous snake, they were bit by sin in another way. God has delivered them. God has redeemed them. 400 years of slavery and oppression are done. And what do they do as next step? They must be the most gracious, heartfelt, heart-touched, God-honoring people that have ever lived. Exact opposite. And we need to take note of this. They are entitled. They are griping. "God, this food is," and the word in my Bible is, "it is miserable." I don't say we're kind of done with it. It's a little bit off. "This is the worst." And we know in later stories what they're smacking of is, "Can we just go back? Can we go? God, being in sin and slavery is better than being with you." You talk about being bit by sin. You talk about being someone who is a consumer, complaining. Book of Romans, we read about this fantastic fall that begins with, "And they did not thank God." It's exactly where these people are. The redeemed are nothing more than revolting rebels. Can you see yourself in this story? Can you see yourself being one who doesn't thank God? Can you see yourself as one that'll see an entire church service go on, and instead of finding the 99 things that are right, you find that one thing that's off, and you let somebody know about it? Can you find that same thing happening in your family, blessing after blessing, but the one person who's got that one thing, boy, you dwell on that, and it manifests itself in your life? You look like you've been sucking on a prune. And there is no joy, and people in the world say, "If that's a Christian, then no thanks." These people have been bit by sin. And God, in this next part of the story, he just brings to reality what's already happened. These venomous snakes come into the midst of the camp. People die. People are ailing. People are on death's doorstep. And God sends grace. In Numbers 21 and 9, it reads this way. The Lord said to Moses, "Make a snake, put it up on a pole. Anyone who is bitten," I think about us bitten with sin, "anyone who is bitten can look at it and live." Kevin Neiman, one of the great blessings of this church, not only a counselor at our counseling office, but running that ministry at a grand level. This would be the part I don't mean to step in Kevin's head, but he's a good enough friend where he can tell me later, no, that's not at all what I do, Mitch. But this may be the part where a counselor would go, no, wait a minute. You just had people bitten by a snake, God. You've got people who have lost a loved one because they've been bitten by a snake. And let's be honest, when a snake comes into your camp, it's already gross. It's to me, I'm Indiana Jones. Remember when we looked down in that pit? It had to be snakes, okay? Snakes and tarantula. When I get to heaven, I'm going to go, why, God, what were you thinking, okay? These aren't just snakes that are anonymous to your condition. They have wiped out some of your friends. And God says for your healing to live, not only look at a snake that hadn't done a thing, but I want you to manufacture that thing that bit you and is leading to your death and put it up on a pole, and I want you to gaze at it. I want you to look at it, and as you look at that, that's when you're going to find your healing. Modern day counselor might say that's cruel and unusual punishment. Brothers and sisters, let me tell you something. If you're entitled in your marriage, and you're wanting your spouse to be the best spouse instead of where you used to be in being the best spouse, if you want your kids to come up to this level, but yet you as a child of God are not living in the grace and stunned awe every day that you get to be a kid in His kingdom, if sin has bit you and you feel entitled, John 3 and 14 says this. It's another gross picture. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the desert, so the most beautiful one ever, the fairest of 10,000, the Prince of Glory, the Alpha and the Omega, the one without sin, the Lamb of God, the Son of Man, He must be lifted up on a pole that everyone who looks to Him, that everyone who believes in Him may have, unlike numbers, have a healing for a moment. You look to this grotesque figure. And some of us have talked about the cross so long, it's not grotesque to us anymore. We don't see the blood anymore. We don't see the crown of thorns anymore. We don't see in Jesus those whip marks and understand that it is my sin that put Him there. Brothers and sisters, let that sink in for a moment. Sink in, you look at that and you want to look away and go, but the Bible says, to everyone who looks at that and believes in what He said about that, that the one who took our stripes and our transgressions, and now I'm free and I'm healed and not have life but have eternal life, and I look at that of what He took for me. You want to talk about this morning being directed to revival? That will direct you to revival. No wonder the writer of Hebrews 12 and 2 said, we kind of look. We look sometimes when we're really low. We fix our eyes on Jesus, the author of our faith, the author of our life. This is the guard against temptation. This is the guide to repentance. And this is what it is to be directed to revival in everything in your life. How is God the Spirit speaking to your heart today? How is He begging you, as you have been bit by sin, to receive a healing that can only come from Him? Mitch, I'm pretty good. I'm not Nineveh or Manasseh. You got flies in your life? And you want the aroma of Christ where your kids and your parents and your co-workers go, what's that smell? That's Jesus. And that's the anointing that comes from Him. And it is an acceptable offering, not only to him, but a sweet aroma to all those around. That is a life we've been called to. That is a life that you can come to today. You can receive that anointing today through baptism, through full immersion, through coming to him. And he doesn't cover you a little bit. He covers you all the way. And the Bible speaks of that as a new birth and a new life. And if you want to learn more about that, we can talk a lot about that and would love to do that. If you want to come today and say, I've got some flies in my life. I'm being a husband, a wife, a parent, a coworker, a neighbor. And I want that sweet perfume to be restored. I want to be pure in the Lord. If you want to be a part of this body of believers, every last one of us, all have sinned. But every last one of us being, as we confess, covered and in communion with God. Today, how can you come as we stand and as we sing?